So, this is third part or third lecture of today, and now we actually talk about science in a more strict sense. We talk about cortical variability, in particular cortical variability dynamics. I will explain what we mean with this, and some of you will know about this. It has become a rather famous topic, and by chance it was the topic of my PhD thesis, which was a while ago, and recently it has been quite of interest. And so I give you an overview over experimental observations, the phenomenology, but also the recent models that people have come up with to explain this. And you will measure variability, time-resolved, static, two types of variability in the data today. And this can be very helpful for the challenge you're going to be facing next week. You don't know yet of that challenge, but it's going to be an interesting challenge, and that can be quite useful. Okay, so this is the outline of this lecture. Let me start with some motivation. This is three slides. First slide. If you look at neocortex, with the only exception, let's say, of auditory cortex 1, maybe, you usually expect permanent activity. That is, there is always spontaneous activity, and this is an intercellular recording of a free from a neuron from prefrontal cortex in an anesthetized rat. You have seen this type of experiments before in my first lecture. And what you see here is membrane potential over time, 5 seconds, one intercellular recording. That is, by the way, last author of your supervisor. Yes. Now, why is this membrane potential at minus 50 and not at the textbook minus 70? Or minus 55 for the matter? Yeah, somebody else maybe also? So why is this not minus 70?
It's a constant stream of input.
Yes, so the answer is there's a constant input impinging on this neuron, okay? So the minus 70 is neuron in vitro, neuron in culture, neuron in isolation. Yeah, that's what we sort of, that's the reversal, you know, what the equations tell us due to reversal potentials, electric driving force, etc. But in the real brain, here we have lots of inputs. And this here is a zoom in, okay? This is now 100 milliseconds. This is a spike. I just cut it here. But what you see here is lots of fast upstrokes, which belong to EPSPs. So these are excitatory postsynaptic potentials. You can also see IPSP, inhibitory postsynaptic potentials here. On top, there's also some measurement noise, certainly. So it's not all fluctuation from input. But anyhow, so you can nicely see how it builds up here before it actually generates an output spike. Yeah. Okay, so we have permanent activity, and what people argued, or sort of the textbook knowledge, is that in neocortex, spiking is irregular. With irregular, it's meant that it's not like tick, 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 like a clock, right? But it's tack, 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 okay? So if you are doing recordings, you know this sort of noise from, you know, just connecting speaker to your recording. Yeah, so that's an issue that we're gonna come to later. So that's again here. The spikes occur irregular in interval with irregular intervals. So this is a repetition of the same experiment. This is now again data from a monkey. Time axis and trial number is not really important here. It's just that you see that there is this irregularity. Yeah. But the, let's say, striking feature that has been reported in the 90s. And people have talked a lot about it in the late 90s and 2000s, is where does this large trial-by-trial variability come from? And this is a classic, really a classic paper here from Amos Arieli and co-workers, Art Erzen, last author, he retired professor in Freiburg. So what do you see here? You see recordings from Area 17 of a cat, so visual area 17, that's approximately V1. The cat is anesthetized, eyes are open, and it watches a video on its, at that time, classical screen, okay? And it sees the same video over and over again, okay? And while the cat sees this visual input, this time-dependent visual input, they record here from a 2x2 millimeter, I hope, surface of the cat area 17 with voltage-sensitive dye imaging. That has been, it's a bit out of use these days, but it's a dye that binds to the membrane and reports, I mean by means of changing its reflectance, I think, or maybe also its fluorescence, I'm even not 100% sure, it's fluorescence, I guess, according to the transmembrane voltage. Okay, so what you see here is basically membrane patch. Okay, and over many neurons, okay? And this is time zero. This is when this short movie stimulus starts, and this is 112 milliseconds later. And this is A is first trial, B is the second trial. And what you should see here is that they don't look alike much, okay? So this you record in one trial, and this in the second trial. It's identical stimulus. The cat cannot move, it's not awake, there's not much of active sensing going on. At the same time, they had an electrode sticking in at this position, and they recorded local field potentials, okay, and single unit activity from this one electrode. And this is just a voltage-sensitive dye here at this position, at this pixel. And basically, you know, it's not obvious that they have to do anything, I mean, they have anything in common, these two trials. Okay, the spikes are completely different, the LFP looks different, and so on. Okay, I think this is a very nice paper here, and they also have an interesting interpretation. But this is sort of motivating the problem. Okay, where does this variability come from? And another question is, if this is sort of noisy, sort of, if this is meant to be noise, how can the brain actually work under such noisy conditions? Yeah, what do we do? So in experiments, what has been done classically, or what we do in a first, let's say, stupid approximation, we just repeated 100 times, we have 100 trials, and we average, okay? And then we see some average response. But obviously the brain cannot, I mean, life is single trial, okay? If you have to cross a busy street in Berlin, for example, you cannot say, okay, I do it 10 times, and then I average, you know, and I survived 0.8. Okay, that does not work. Okay, you're either dead or alive. So the point is, the brain somehow works in single trial, and that is why understanding the nature of variability is very important. Then this is another classical paper by Shetland and Newsom in 1998. They also looked at here. This is visual cortex, if I remember correctly. Maybe it was MT. Haven't read it for 20 years, but anyhow, so what they reported is in visual areas that they find that they measured, they counted the number of spikes, like in this little piece here, okay, over trials, and they measured the variance of this spike count, so how large is the variance, and what is the mean? And they say that the variance is about 1 to 1.5 times larger than the mean, okay? Variance divided by mean of a count number is what we call the Fanner factor, named after some chemist who looked into Brown in motion. But basically, we call this the Fanner factor, okay? And they said, okay, the Fanner factor is larger than one. The variance is larger than the mean. And this is a bit striking because if we look at the Poisson process, and you probably have heard of a Poisson process, the Poisson process is a stochastic point process that has a high randomness in a sense. It has a maximum entropy under certain sort of description. And it has a Fanner factor of 1. Okay? So for the Poisson process, the variance equals to 1. And that's really, really variable. So why should this be even worse or around 1? Okay? one hypothesis or one conclusion from this paper and other papers is that some people actually said, okay, single neuron spiking is more variable than the Poisson process, and actually there we need even more irregular processes or processes that are more noisy than Poisson, which has led to the fact that a lot of modelers, for example, in cortical network models, think they have to have CVs and Fan effectors larger than one. I think this is simply a misunderstanding, but that's another issue. So, as a matter of fact, it's not true that the single neuron as such is more variable than a Poisson process. Yeah? And this is what I try to convince you now. And unfortunately, I have to get the sun out. Okay. So this is still sort of motivation. What are the sources of trial-to-trial variability in the brain? Is this sort of a noise for the system or a nuisance? Where does it come from? And that's more a methodological or technical question. How can we measure it reliably? That's important for you. Okay. I borrowed this sketch here from an older paper from De Weese and Seder. They depicted a neuron here, and they said, okay, we have output spike trains, we have presynaptic input spike trains, we have synapses, and we have channels and so on. And usually we look at output variability, so we look at how variable are action potential trains or spike trains of individual neurons. And this should depend on intrinsic sources, that's how I would call them. They call it private noise. So they're intrinsic sources. For example, synaptic transmission is actually quite variable. Again, something that is often or actually mostly ignored in network simulations. So we have, and others have done experiments looking at cortical transmission, cortico-cortical transmission, and you have a large variation in amplitudes, and you have failures and things like that from one transmission to the next. But there's of course also extrinsic sources, which is sort of the input. Is the input already variable? Yeah, and of course the output is input to another neuron. These are the questions one can address. And I took this part out because it would just have taken too long today. So neuron intrinsic source of variability. So there's a body of literature out there where people looked at how reliable is dendritic integration, how reliable is synaptic transmission, how reliable is invasion of axons, and so on. What is intrinsic channel noise? And for the cortex, my conclusion would be here, of what I don't show, of course there's variability, but it does not at all account for this very high variability we see in vivo. Okay, it has nothing to do with the trial-by-trial variability we encounter there. It's much lower. It makes a contribution on a much lower scale. Yeah. And I will, in the references, I will give a sort of, for this point, also a list of papers that you can have a look at. Yes? So, just, can you?
What is the alternative of variability being noise to the system?
Okay, what is the alternative of variability being noise to the system is a very good question. Yeah? The answer is, the way we look at it, we might look at it from a wrong perspective, and in that sense, variability might be epiphenomic in a sense. Okay, so it might this system creates this variability. It's certainly not thermal noise or something. So the question is, does the function of the network maybe? I mean, this is in the end. I will try to conclude that our current models suggest that the way it functions, yeah, leads to the fact that we see this high variability, okay, but it has nothing to do with the processing of the network, okay? Yeah? I'll try to arrive there. Okay, so neuron intrinsic factors are, sources are too small to explain it. Let's put it this way. That's at least my opinion. So next thing is, before we look into more data analysis of this, how do we measure interval and count variability? And we look at both. That will be important. Okay, I can point to this nice book that Sonja Grün and Stefan Rotter edited already 9 years ago, but there's one chapter on this issue. So we have already established what is a spike train. If we have a spike train, there are, from a statistical point of view, there are exactly two random variables that we can estimate, yeah, or that we can work with. So we have the intervals in between spikes, and this is continuous. This is called a continuous random variable, and we have the number of spikes, which is discrete because there can only be, you know, if you count, you can only count 7 or 8, but not 7.3. Yeah, this is the only data that we have access to, so to speak. Okay, that's the. And then, of course, we come up with models and try to fit models to explain this. But for the time being, we only have intervals and a number of spikes. And number of spikes, you can translate this in firing rate if you wish. Yeah. And now, if we go from statistics to stochastic theory, if you go to math, then there is a whole body, or I mean, there's a field that is called point process theory that can also, that can, where you define, mathematically define processes that generate events in time, discrete events in time. If a process is defined, then the two variables are actually closely related. Okay? Yeah? They are closely related, and maybe this sort of formula here, in this abstract formula, explains it quite well. So tau k is the sum over all intervals from 1 to k. Let's say 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, this would be tau 4 here. Yeah, and one can say now that the probability, this is again, and the notation here is probability of tau k being smaller or equal t, yeah, is the same as the probability of observing n spikes, n spikes in the same interval from 0 to t, being n being k larger or equal to k. So basically what it says is, okay, if you go along here, okay, the probability of observing a fifth spike, yeah, is about the same of this being the sum of these four intervals, something, yeah, trying to be intuitive. The point I want to make here is the two measurements are related, okay, and they are related in interesting manner, and now we can use quantities, statistical quantities, we estimate quantities from our data and relate them to see, to infer what type of process we are working, we deal with. We could, for example, exclude some processes, okay? And so what is often used then is the Fanner factor, we talked about this. So I cause repeated trials in a fixed observation window. I count the number of spikes, 5, 5, 5, okay, this is 4, 6 or so, and then I compute the variance across trials and divide it by the mean, okay? And we also use the coefficient of variation of interspike intervals, and we usually use it in a squared manner. So we use the variance of the interspike intervals divided by the squared mean. Okay, so we take many intervals, like all of these, for example, compute the variance and divide it by the mean squared. Or the CV would be the standard deviation by the mean. In any case, it's dimensionless. That's why it's called a coefficient. Yeah. And the interesting thing is now that these two are nicely related for most processes we look at. For example, if we look at stationary processes, that are stationary in time, what I mean is that the intensity or firing rate does not change. Okay, that's not very, very realistic for a neuron for the time being, but we have to deal with this. Then this formula holds here, something you can dig out of this very cool book from the 60s. What it says is that the Fanner factor is equal to CV squared times 1 plus 2 times the serial correlations. So if intervals are correlated, what does it mean? A correlation means, for example, if the last interval, I mean, it means that, for example, if intervals are getting larger and larger and larger, then they have a positive correlation. Yeah? We will look at this in an example. So you correlate, serially correlate intervals, okay? So is the fifth you compare a fifth interval with a fourth, and the fourth with the third, and the third with the second, and so on. Okay, yeah, and that you get a statistic. It's like cross-correlating two variables. It's correlating across time. Yeah, you lag it sort of. Yeah, and then you ask for higher correlation and so on. And for all higher correlations, so if you sum them all up, okay, this means CV squared plus 2 times CV squared times Xi, basically. And more interesting is if you talk about renewal processes, then the two measures are typically equal. And for example, the Poisson process is a renewal process. And the renewal process just means, okay, I will explain this in a second. Maybe important is this is of course a limit result. Obviously, we don't have infinite time amount of time to record from a monkey or something. So we have to come to some practical terms, and that's what this part of the lecture is about. It's, you know, it's a bit boring, but it's method. Okay. So what is a renewal process? I give you a very famous example. So can anybody recognize what this could be here? This is Middle Ages. This is 8 years ago. What could that be? Do we have any Catholic in here? Catholic people here? It's popes. Yes, exactly. It's popes. Yeah. Okay. Popes is a renewal process because whenever one pope dies, you replace him. Okay. And renewal means that the lifetime of the fifth pope is independent of the lifetimes of the fourth pope and the third pope, and anyhow of the popes in the future. By yeah. And that's the pun. They're old, yeah. Well, they start old. In any case, so the idea is of renewal means this whole theory comes from industrialization. How can we make workers work all night and children all night and stuff? How many light bulbs do I need? How often do I have to replace them? Okay, that's where it comes from. But basically, renewal means you renew a pope, you instant a new pope, and has no relation to the old one. We usually also, I quietly assumed that we have an orderly process. It means that you never have two spikes at the same time, which is true for neurons. In popes, it's a bit different. We had popes and antipopes at earlier times. And also we have, and I measured actually here CV for the popes, and it's extremely high. And if you look into it a bit more closely, there are a few popes who were pope very short because they were assassinated. So that makes high interval variability. Yeah. But it's a nice, I think, explanation of what a renewal process is. The question is, are neurons renewal processes or not? So renewal processes are very often used to simulate neuronal processes, okay? And you can also make them with changing firing rates, okay? So renewal process by definition is actually no change in firing rate, but you enforce this, yeah? There are ways of doing, sort of combining renewal theory and changes of intensity. Okay. Now, how can we measure CV and Fanon factor? So here, this is from a simulation, but basically you have spike trains repeatedly. This I call operational time. Operational time means this is the average length of one interval. It doesn't. So if the rate is double, then this is just half the size. Okay, we call this operational time. This is the average intervals. So we observe now only a very short period, on average 2 intervals. That's of course really short. One should not do that. But actually it happens. Yeah? So you might look at an interval of 400 milliseconds before and after stimulus, and before stimulus maybe the rate is so low that you only have 1, 2, or 3 spikes in your observation, yeah? Typically. What happens is if you have this finite observation, not an infinite, is that this would be the true interval distribution, the distribution of intervals, the probability of intervals that I used for simulating this, and this is the observed one. Yeah, because I cannot observe any interval that is longer than 2 by definition. Okay, so it's truncated here, so and then renormalized. So what you have, it's more narrow. Or in other words, the CV you measure, the interval variability, is always smaller than the true one. Okay, because you don't have infinite time to observe. And this is the black lines, and this here is sort of depending on operational time and for different processes. So the, you know, the true, for example, this is the Poisson process. So the true CV, squared CV is 1, but if you measure it with small, in small windows, you underestimate it. That's all you need to know. It's not a bad thing, but you have to know it, okay? And then we, you know, we come up with some rule of thumb for, you know, any practical purposes, you know, and say, okay, let's try to have not less than 5 spikes on average in my interval. And the Fanner factor, it's a bit more complicated, but the Fanner factor basically always tends to 1, yeah? But its bias comes in rather late. So if you have a very small interval, you can think of it, if this interval is almost infinitely small, then you either have a spike or no spike, no matter what the process is, and your variance becomes equal to the mean somehow, because you approximate a Bernoulli process. Doesn't, yeah. Okay. If you have this in mind, it just means try to use larger intervals. If you want to have good quantities, use small ones, know of the bias to look, for example, at dynamics. That's fine, okay? As long as you know what you're doing, you can do almost everything. So conclusion one here is the point process theory links interval and count statistics. That's interesting because we can test now in our real data what does it look like. The Fanner factor and CV have this bias for estimation. Okay, let's look into cortical variability. And I don't start with the behaving monkey, but I start with experiments that we did to understand this a bit more, a bit better, we and others. Okay. So we started by injecting currents, noise currents, into in vitro recording into pyramidal neurons of somatosensory cortex in rats. Okay, so this is in vitro, so it's acute slice preparation. This is a glass pipette that you see here in the infrared image. This scale here is 20 micrometers. This is the pyramidal cell. Up here is the PL surface. And what we inject through this into the neuron is a current, a noisy current. And the noisy current is constructed by point processes. We use point processes. So I assume excitatory presynaptic neurons. I assume inhibitory presynaptic neurons. I convolve them with excitatory or inhibitory currents. If I sum them up, I get a funny current. And this is the voltage recording now. Okay, the action potentials are cut here so that you can actually see how this looks like. So it actually looks pretty well, pretty similar to in vivo recording. Okay, so we fool the cell by injecting currents and we see what is the cell's output. And we can do that in different ways. So by we can change this input statistics such that this is more or less variable. So for example, we have only excitatory input, okay, and they are Poissonian distributed in time, the inputs, I mean, the these inputs here, Poisson distributed, the red ones, and then this is how the noise looks like. This is called shot noise. You know, it's a low-pass filtered Poisson process is called shot noise. Yeah. So you inject this, and this is how the neuron reacts. This is the voltage trace. And this is always the same neuron, all 4 times, but we did here on the right side, we balance excitation with inhibition, but not fully, but with a 2-to-1, so there is sort of a mean positive current, and something changes here. You can see it by eye. It becomes more irregular and more spikes because you drive it by more fluctuations, the neuron. And the lower left now, we did again pure excitation, but now that it wasn't a Poisson process, but a clustered process, so the the inputs come in bursts, like okay, let's say. So it becomes even noisier. And if we combine this again with inhibition here, then it becomes really, really noisy. Okay? So if in these 4 conditions, for these 4 conditions now, we measured Fanner factor and the squared CV. And as I said, identity here, they would be the same for renewal processes. Okay? Yeah? And if we do this with these neurons, then we find that these are the different conditions, the noise conditions, and if this with the strongest noise, we get the highest values of Fanner factor and CV2. This is these triangles here. With the lowest noise condition, they're all down here. But basically, they all fall nicely on this identity line, and this shading in the back here is a confidence limit that we did by simulations. So basically, because you have, of course, a variance of estimation, we only record for several seconds and so on, so we have a limited amount of data, so we always have an estimation variance also. Yeah. Okay. So this looks pretty nice, and it comes up with rather small values. And you will see later that in vivo, and I said it initially, right, that Shetland and Newsom and others showed, you know, fan effectors are 1 or 1.5 or something. If you do this in vitro thingy here, this is in the order of 0.5 or smaller, yeah, and they are roughly equal. Okay. And other people have looked typically in either or these two measurements, and they all fit to these measurements, but we cannot easily we cannot explain anything in vivo with this. So let's do in vivo recordings. This is again interstellar recording in vivo from rat, anesthetized, but now we used pieces of low anesthesia, and where there were we cut out traces of recording where there was no downstates. There were no downstates. And then it looks like this, much pretty similar to this in vitro injection type. And we again, now we have only 8 cells, but we again measured fan effector and CV squared. And what we find is, again, they are really small. Okay, the scale goes from 0.1 to 0.6. So they are smaller than, again, around 0.5 or so. Yeah, only half of the size of a Poisson process. And interestingly, the fan effector, so these orange lines are the real sort of the recordings, and they all, on average, they're on to the left of this identity line, and that means that the fan effector is actually smaller than the CV squared. Yeah? And if we, okay, what could be a reason for this if this is not the same? I showed you this equation before. Do you have an idea what? Yeah.
Serial correlation.
Yeah. So we can now test whether serial correlation is the reason for this, because this is rather stationary here. So we took pieces where the weight doesn't change much. So if you shuffle the intervals, if you just randomize them and you do the same analysis, the CV is by definition the same. Okay. This doesn't change by shuffling the intervals, but the fan effector does change. And the fan effector, and now the gray ones suddenly are more or less on this identity line. So shuffling intervals destroys this smaller than relation, and this might be due to serial correlations here. So what type of serial correlations do I need that the fan effector is smaller than CV squared? They have to be negative, okay? They have to be negative. If this is negative, okay, then this becomes smaller than this. And so if we now estimate from this data serial correlations, indeed we have of order 1, 2, 3, and so on. The first order serial correlations, so neighboring intervals, they are negatively correlated for 7 out of 8 neurons, and the 8th one is this one that anyhow didn't change much here, okay? Okay, so there seem to be serial correlations in this data, and this is not only and this is a simulation, but not so important, but there are papers out there that look at serial correlations and find them all over the place in different systems. There's not so much reports on the neocortex because it's more difficult to do. But I can tell you that one possibility or one cellular mechanism that induces negative serial correlation is adaptation, spike frequency adaptation. And that's again ubiquitous across animal kingdom, yeah? A lot of spiking neurons do have the machinery to produce adaptation currents, including cortical neurons. So there has been a nice paper, I think, by the group of Adrian Fairhall, if I'm correct, looking into this. So we have to deal with these issues. Yeah. So we don't have a. We don't. They are not renewals. The real neurons don't seem to be renewal. They have negative correlations. If you go back to the in vitro data and you look at it very carefully, you also find it. Now, if we look in this nice paper from the lab of Shigeru Shinomoto, a theoretical neuroscientist, but he talked to, I don't know, 100 or something, experimenter, and asked for their data and talked to them so long until they got tired, sick and tired, and gave the data to him. And then he analyzed across different different species, mammalian species, and different recording areas, hippocampus, prefrontal cortex, visual cortex, motor cortex, the regularity or irregularity of neurons. He did not use the CV or CV squared or any other of these related measures. He used a dispersion index or dispersion measure, which nevertheless is similar. It's just well, it's let me think of it. It's regularity, so the higher, the more regular. Yeah, it's a bit opposite to the CV. Basically, what they find that it seems that in motor areas, recordings are more regular and they are more irregular in sensory areas. This is also my my experience. So we mostly worked on cortical data, and there it's a bit more regular. So the CVs are lower. On the other hand, the Fanner factors are highest there. Okay, in the motor system. Yes, please.
If you were to know the adaptation, for instance, if you have a neural model, artificial neural model, you know the adaptation parameter, would you be able to retrieve this adaptation factor out of the spectrum?
Okay, yes. So the question is whether by fitting, adapting a model, a neural model, that has adaptive currents to spike trains, whether we can sort of infer, let's say, the spike frequency adaptation parameter of this model. And the answer is yes. And a group that has been very active in this field is the group of Wolfram Gerstner in Lausanne. They have been, over years, improving single neuron models to predict spike trains of recordings. And yes, I mean, they had to incorporate some sort of adaptation to properly predict spiking, cortical spiking, which is not so surprising. And yes, there are variants of models around that you can fit. Some of them are more phenomenological, some of them are more mechanistical, and then you estimate these parameters as good as you can. But again, it's not as easy as they typically describe it in papers, I would say. Yes, please.
When you say here interval variability, is that just the regular variability across all of the intervals, or is that like a drift in the intervals from the beginning of the end?
I mean overall.
Overall,
but it's a good question, because we have to talk about how to estimate them. Okay, because there are different ways of estimating this variability. So basically, you have to estimate it locally and then average. Because if the firing rate changes, then of course over a long time the intervals will be extremely variable, right? They are small when the rate is high, and they are long when the rate is low. And that's of course not what we want to look at. We want to look at sort of the imaginary static state variability of intervals, or regularity, irregularity. Okay, but maybe it will become more clear to the next examples, but also when you will work on this data, right? Because we're going to help you, and you will find out how it is. Okay, so conclusion from this smaller part here was under stationary input conditions, in vitro, also in vivo, we tried this. In a balanced network, I mean, we in vitro, we could sort of regulate this a little bit. Cortical neurons are less variable than the Poisson process, so both irregularity is low, Fanner factor is low, and we have this relation here, most likely due to serial correlations, negative serial correlations, yeah. And so adaptation, negative serial correlations are actually a sink of variability, right? They reduce variability in the system. That's something we is sort of biologically interesting and relevant. And I want to point to this thing here. Poisson process is a deficient model. If it wouldn't be recorded, I would use a different name. But anyhow, it's not a good model for single for cortical neurons, or for any neuron, actually spiking neuron, still we like to use it in math, and that makes sense. Sometimes you want to do approximations, yeah. But don't be fooled and make simulations of networks and try to be Poissonian. Okay, I mean that's like trying to be unbiological. Okay, good. Now to the interesting part, and this is the data that you, again, the data that you will use. You have seen this experiment before. So monkey sits here in the monkey chair in front of this vertical panel, okay? This is trial start. He has his hand in the center here. This is vertical. He will be asked to move his hand to one out of six targets. At time zero, he gets the target shown here. This is the one target condition. I will show the other conditions later. Then he has to wait for 1 second, and this will turn from green to red, and then he's allowed to move, okay? Reaction times will be fast because he can anticipate, he does exactly know, he can prepare here exactly which movement he will have to execute. And then we have this preparation period, exclusion period separated. This is now three neurons recorded in parallel, I think. From primary motor cortex in this case. This is monkey one in your data. And we look at interval variability. So we look at the interspike intervals. And of course, this is variability of a short time scale, okay? On the order of one interspike interval. Yeah, we measure the variance and the mean. But we also look at the final factor. But we should not forget that, you know, here these are grouped trials where the monkey moved to the same direction, yeah, but in between every second, each of two trials are maybe 30 seconds or something, yeah. So because he has randomized different directions, okay, and this is over many minutes here, okay. So you actually have a much longer time scale. So from trial to trial, a lot of time can pass by, yeah. Okay. Okay, we do this, and I still haven't talked about how we can estimate this. So what I ask you to use in the exercise is the so-called CV2. It's a local measure. It's explained there. So we only use two neighboring intervals, basically. We measure the variance of those two divided by the mean, and then we go to the next, and to the next, and to the next. And then we have a very local measure that is more or less, or to a large extent, independent of firing rate changes that are slower than one or two intervals, yes? There are other means, and actually in this rather old figure, this is from my PhD thesis, I did use a different method. I don't explain in detail now, but what you see here is again the Fanner factor, oops, for exactly this data here, I'm sorry, and the squared CV. This is a logarithmic scale, and we get huge Fanner factors, okay, up to 10 or 12. That's gigantic. I try to simulate this with point processes. I mean, you can't do it all. It's basically impossible, except if you introduce non-stationarities. I come to this. And the CV squared is in the order of 0.1 to up to 2 or 2.5. But this is also biased because the variability is so high across trials. And in this case, I used intervals from pulled them from different trials. And then you are already a little bit, you know, well, you're in deep shit already because the intervals are different because your count, I mean, the rate is so changing so much from trial to trial. So you have to use the other ways around it. But at this, I had a good reason for using it here. And then you see that the Fanner factor is about 2 to 3 times higher than the CV squared. Yeah, or it's even more, 4 times. And it's on average. So average numbers are between 2 and 3, okay? Yes, and Fanner factor over CV squared is about 2.4. Yeah. Now, this is not consistent with what I showed you before in vitro. Okay, there's something different. Something's going on here, from here to here. This is the same type of neurons. Okay, this is a rat and this is a monkey, but that's not the point. You find the same in the rat. So basically, there is something that is not intrinsic to the neurons. I think this is something I would like to hypothesize already at this point. This must be some extrinsic sources, let's say. And if you now look at the Fanner factor over time of this experiment, so this is before the, here is the monkey gets the cue, this is time before, this is the 900 milliseconds of the waiting period, and this is again an equal length period around movement onset. And these are the distributions of the Fanner factors, and they go from large numbers around 2 in the spontaneous state, let's say, down to small numbers, 1.1, 1.3, during movement. So they reduce a lot. And this is now an important finding that has been much discussed. This is the same data now, time resolved, and you will do this in this data. Okay, you just take a window and move it across the spike trains, and you always measure for each trial the count, and then you measure divide the variance by the mean, and this is what you get out of it. And this is that you can see that in relation to the task triggers, the variability goes down, then it comes up again, and it goes down again during movement. I'll show you this later. Okay, so variability is actually modulated in a task relevant manner. And this has been very prominently published by Mark Church and his group. Okay, so they first showed it in motor cortex, like we did in the first paper, and then they here in this paper they again collected data from different sensory areas and motor areas, and you find this Fanner factor here go down, go down, go down rather sharply. Okay. And this is always the stimulus onset. Yeah, here it's a grating, here it's this crossed gratings that give you a movement impression. That's area MT, area visual area 4, here directional sensitive, again motion sensitive, and here premotor dorsal as a motor area. When the monkey starts to move, it goes down. This is more slowly. That's also what we see, but actually it's also partly due to the fact that we don't have internal trigger to align movement data as we can do it with sensory stimuli. So trial variability is large. Count variability is larger than interval variability, much larger, which tells us that there's some inconsistency. It's certainly nothing to do with a stationary process that we usually think of. And the Fanner factor is reduced during the task. Okay, and this Churchland paper has been very influential, and people have then started to think about where does this come from. And this is my final part now. I will describe some models. Okay, I start with, an older model that we thought of, and that is maybe partly true, we don't know really. So we thought, okay, these are different trials over time when the monkey is performing the identical trials, but maybe the overall network state is changing homeostatically to whatever reasons, neuromodulation, attention, and so on. Maybe this already is sufficient to at least explain mechanistically why we see this high variability. This is now from firing rate estimated over a long period of time from, again, averaged across many neurons from monkey brain, and indeed it changes in a small range, but it changes quite a bit, sort of the average network activity. And these are the real trials that have been done in this experiment. And what we did, again, we went back to in vitro experiments, and what we did is we injected noise current, but we artificially introduced trials. So this was always 5 seconds long, and then we changed the intensities of these excitatory and inhibitory inputs. But we only changed it by 2% or 10%, 2, 5 or 10%. Yeah? And this is how it looks like. You here, for example, is a little jump, but you can hardly see it. Okay, it's almost invisible for us. What does the neuron do with this type of changes? And if you do that, so the black one are controls, and here this open, the open symbols here show you for 2, 5 and 10% what happens to Fanner factor relation to the CV squared. And indeed, if you have, for example, 5% variation of the input, only 5% from trial to trial, 5% more or less excitation, then we get very large numbers here already, where the Fanner factor is about 2 times, 3 times, 4 times higher than the CV squared. Okay, so it just tells you that indeed, if there is a non-stationarity across trials in the input, then we get this high output. And this is something that will happen. The question is only how does it happen? I think this is the only good explanation right now mechanistically, and I think nobody has a different idea that the input to one particular neuron from trial to trial is pretty different. Yeah, the reason is why. And it translates in a sort of a drastic variability in the output. And this sort of on the scale, you can get similar results as we see in the monkey. So that's why now there's a different model, 2A I call it. There will also be 2B, and this is now very rather recent, 2012, 7 years, but that's a good model. And Wahid, sitting here in the back, is also working on this type of models. So they argued, attractor networks. In balanced random networks in the cortex, they don't do much. So we have to think about function. How can a cortex, our cortical model, do something functional? And attractor networks are attractive. They're interesting models because attractor network, first of all, they don't have to be cortical or spiking. Let's talk about abstract about attractor networks. In a certain parameter regimes, they are multi-stable, so attractors can be assumed, but you jump out of attractors and a new one under spontaneous conditions, but under slight stimulations or changes of input or squeezing of input, or you can sort of drive the model to assume certain attractors. Then it could also be interesting that attractors can be strong or weaker, and this could be learned, for example. And then we could use this maybe for decision making, certainly for working memory. There are nice models out there that can explain working memory tasks with attractor networks. Now, if we want to model this in the cortex, then we need many, let's say, several thousand excitatory inhibitory neurons, and we have to somehow generate attractors. And we can do that by architecture. So what they said, basically at the same time here, Gustavo Deco, and here from the Deuron lab, they said, if we have a balanced network, we somehow now pick subgroups of these neurons and we strengthen them. Their interconnection, they strongly have strong excitatory interconnections. So these are excitatory neurons. We talk about excitatory neurons here. So we make clusters. They also have connections to all others, but they're a bit weaker. It's like a social group. You're strongly connected and you're weakly connected to some friends in other strongly connected groups. So we have these excitatory clusters. There's one inhibitory pool. And by doing this, you suddenly get this, what we call multi-stability. So you have attractors that can fall on and off. So this is here a spontaneous, let's say, simulation, spontaneous activity. The gray ones here are the inhibitory neurons. Again, you see a lot of spikes. These are many neurons. And then suddenly, and by this you can actually find these are the clusters here. So this is one cluster here, neurons that, and suddenly they become strongly active. But then they fall off and this gets on, and then they come on again, and then this gets off and this gets on, and then this gets on, and it goes duk, 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 okay? Yeah, they come out of the, these attractors come out of the, let's say, energy level. If you do this, and now if you now do in the spontaneous, if you cut this into pieces and you measure fan effectors and you assume these are trials, then of course, from trial to, so this is only one single trial, the next trial will look very differently. And then you already have a high variability, mainly because within a cluster, you can be active or non-active, so it's almost a bimodal thing for this type of model. But the interesting thing is now that the Fano factor is in, so if this is now a stimulation here we stimulate one cluster, yes. Which one is stimulated here, actually? These are not inhibitory, I'm sorry. These are just the ones that are stimulated here. So five clusters are stimulated here, and then they will be highly active, and the others will be suppressed because there's still this global inhibition. And now, if we assume this to be a trial, an experiment, and we do the we slide a window along to measure fan effector, we find, they're really high, like in real data, and they go down and come up again as sort of in real data. And I think it's a nice model. Yeah? If you don't have these clusters, it's just like that. This is just the balanced random network. So that has been, if you wish, a breakthrough or a good idea. Has been a good idea. It still is a good idea. It can explain this variability. And at this point, one could say, look, if this attractor network type is a processing type, this comes back to your question, and we look at an individual neuron across trials, and in a recording we wouldn't see this, right? We don't know how to, if you randomized the order here, you don't see this anymore. We see one neuron and we repeat, this is only one trial altogether, and if you have 10 trials of this, there will be high variability, because sometimes this neuron is on and sometimes it's off. And for us it's variable, but for the brain it's not the point. Yeah, because it just computes something, and it computes it in different orders or different time steps each time. Now, if we remodel this. I mean, we had a bit of a difficulty to reconstruct these models. You have to be very careful with the parameters and the parameter range. But what we found is, indeed, the firing rates are always pretty high if inside is such a cluster, and the CV goes down to rather small values. Outside, they are normal. Now it's CV2, but don't be confused for the moment. It still means irregularity, but inside a cluster it goes down quite a bit, because it's not burst. I wouldn't call it burst firing, but let's say regular strong firing. And this is not necessarily what we see in the data. So we have, let's say, issues with this model that we would try to improve. That's what I'm going to show you in 2B. So firing weights are really high, so you can only have high or low weights, more or less. Regular spiking during the active clusters is not really what we see in the data. And the model is sensitive to simulation parameters. I will show you this in a second. So what we thought now is that we could do the following. Each of these excitatory clusters in the network also gets a private inhibitory cluster that is strongly interconnected and loosely with others. So you have each cluster has also its private inhibitor, let's say, more or less. Okay. If we do this, so this is monkey data again. I showed you before this sort of Fanon factor decrease in the monkey data. And this is how the CV looks like, or CV2 in this case. It's actually flat. It does not change. Okay. This is the model I showed you before, the EE model, and we have this, the CV is really going down and coming up again. This is not really what we want. That's basically referring to your question. And we have another issue. If we do strong stimulation, we get nicely reduced, Fanon effect is nicely reduced. So this is stimulus amplitude, but if we do this weak grayish stimulation here, then we often have an increase in Fanon effect. That's really awkward. That is because sometimes you trigger the jump and sometimes you don't. Okay, it's sometimes just not enough to trigger this jump. Okay, if we do this what we call EI clustering now, we can solve this issue a little bit. We have the CV now more constant and Fanon factor is decaying. Okay, so we are not talking about models and you will analyze the data, but I think it's interesting to understand a bit of this interpretation. Yeah. That is currently around, right? This is sort of what people, including us, are currently think is are good models to understand it. Yes, please.
In your model 2B, the neuron models are population models?
Ah, no, okay. So the neuron models are, it's good that you ask, the neuron models that we use and they were used in all these slides before is leaky integrated fire neurons, full stop, okay? Leaky integrated fire neurons, it's current-based modeling. We also tried it conductance-based, but we tried to stay in line with the previous publications, let's say. Okay, what is the reason maybe for having this more regular spiking here but not here? If we now look in this pure excitatory clustering, and this is spontaneous, this goes spontaneously up in this upstate here, and then we see that the spiking becomes duk-duk-duk-duk rather regular. And if we look at the current that this neuron receives in this it's one of these neurons here, then it's nicely balanced before it jumps up, but then suddenly excitation goes up, but inhibition doesn't. So basically, within the cluster, the network is driven out of balance. So it's not a random, it's not a balanced network anymore. And that on the right side, we try to keep that, or basically by this excitatory inhibitory clustering, we are much closer to the balanced state, and that is why spiking remains more irregular. And again, this here is the pure excitatory clustering network, and what we also find is that the if we want to find this case where the Fanner factors are high in the beginning, so and this is what I meant with parameter space. So this is the excitatory strength of synapses in the cluster, so this is the cluster strength. There's only a small period where you actually find this jumping multistability, but if we do this EI clustering, then this works nicely over a larger range, and this is shown here, number of clusters, strength of clusters, and we get high Fanner factors as one indicator for this multistability robustly over a larger range of parameters. So this is just sort of a bit of an advancement of the previous models, if you wish. Now, if I come back to the monkey data, that's the very last part now. We had these three conditions. So the monkey either gets a single target with a preparatory signal. He has a delay period of 1 second, and then he reacts and has to move to this one target. But he can also get two or three targets, and one of those two randomly will be the final target or one of those three. So he has full information here, but only incomplete information here. That's what we saw before already. Can we model this is one question. So first of all, if you look at the Fanner factor, the interesting thing is this is context dependent. So depending on the context of this, the Fanner factor, the black is now the one target condition. Okay, it goes down here and then it stays pretty low. Whereas in the other two conditions, it also has this sac, let's say, and it comes back to higher levels. And it somewhat makes sense, yeah? The variability is lowest in the case where the monkey knows what he's going to do, where he has full information, but the variability is higher when he does not know what to do. Yeah? In an attractor network, for example, it might not assume one attractor, but it has to juggle with two or three attractors. And this is what we tried to model. So if we now have a network with only six attractors or six embedded attractors, clusters that can be attractors, and we stimulate either one, two, or three, then what we find is in the model the same, more or less the same thing. So we have a decrease when the Q comes on, and then we have a significant difference between the three different contexts. What is also in what you saw before is this decoding. So if we, this is a directional task, so if we decode the movement direction in the one target condition, we have 100% decoding probability mostly. But if we have two alternative targets, then it's only 50%, one half, and one third for three targets. Yes, please?
How does the decoding probability already rise before T is zero?
Okay. That's because we use a firing rate estimate that is centered. So we use a non-causal kernel, yeah? But you can make this causal. If you want to estimate exactly, for example, the time when it jumps up, yeah? It's a matter of choice, let's say. Okay? You will also deal with this problem. Okay? If you do it in the model, we get the same thing. Okay? And that's quite nice, because we basically stimulate, if we stimulate three clusters, then it jumps between these three clusters. The variance is higher. Okay? And at the for the final target, two of these inputs are cut off or switched off. And then it has to fall into the final cluster, and then it will. We can decode it with 100% probability. So with this rather simple model, let's say, with this clustered attractor networks, we can reproduce this sort of movement selection paradigm. Okay. And very last is if we have adaptation. I talked about adaptation. I just want to tell you, if you have neurons that have adaptive currents, then we also have interesting effects. Namely, again, in the cortical network with adaptive neurons, we have this very strong reduction of the Fanner factor, but for a short time, and this is the time scale of adaptation. So adaptive neuron drive, if neuron in a balanced network are adaptive and they are strongly excited, then they drive themselves out of balance, so to speak. Yeah, they take them out of the, can I say this? And this unbalancing reduces the Fanner factor. And we believe that this is due for this rather steep early reduction that we see in all data that is published. Yeah, and so basically we think that the clustered network plus adaptation is the one that can explain a lot about this phenomenon, but not only. There was recently a nice, very interesting paper where they fitted models to different various data from mice, recordings from mice, and they could only fit the data properly if they introduced adaptation. And I think this is something that also modelers should not forget, that cellular mechanisms are out there that that might be relevant. Yeah. Okay. And this is what I mean. This sharp drop here. Sort of. We think that this is maybe due to adaptation, and that is ongoing work of one of your tutors, Vahid Rostami. Okay. Final conclusions. The Poisson model is, I just repeat this for the third time, is not a good model. Okay. For neuronal spiking. But if you're a mathematician, you're allowed to use it, let's say, or a theoretical physicist, maybe. There are sources of variability. I didn't show you this in detail, but you can try to read this up. That's my hypothesis. Intrinsic factors to neurons are negligible compared to what we observe in vivo. The balance in a balanced network, yeah, you can only explain Fermat factors up to 0.5, 0.6 or something. This is sort of, if you wish, the neuron in a dish or the neuron in under stationary conditions better. This excess variability, the strong variability and the modulation can be explained, reflects non-stationarity across trials. Yeah, okay, that's rather, I think, also rather clear, at least for me, that's what I believe. And we can either think of slow modulation in the background, which is, and this attractor dynamics, and possibly both is there. We also have homeostasis in the brain, obviously. And then there are sinks of variability. Yeah, how is variability reduced? Spike frequency adaptation is a strong measure or a strong mechanism to transiently reduce variability in your output, and that can be, maybe this is really used for coding quite a bit. And of course, I explained the attractor state, the attractor networks that could capture a lot of this variability dynamics. So finally, I just want to thank the people that have been involved in over several years now in all the data that you saw in the analysis. I think it's fair to show them. And you will actually, so you know Sonja already. She is a co-organizer of the course, but also Alexa will be here as a keynote speaker. She will arrive, I don't know, when, this week sometime soon. Vahid is here, okay? Okay. So thank you very much for this, for your attention.